I think it's 9 o'clock. Let's call this meeting to order with a moment of silence. Thank you. First order of business is approve the agenda.
So move.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve the agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion carried. Any public comments before we begin? Seeing nobody jumping up, we'll move on. Let's approve the minutes of April 4.
Motion to approve minutes for April 4.
Support.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carried. Please go down to payroll change for attorney. She has a request on her assistant to change the pay scale. Terry Miniga, effective May 7. Hourly rate through June 30 will be $27.26, and after June 30 will be $28.62. She works 56 hours per pay period or every 2 weeks. So that's a request from Jim.
Move to approve the pay change for Terry Miniga.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve the pay change. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. We have third quarter reports from the Recorder and Veterans Affairs. So they're in here somewhere.
I move to accept the third quarter reports for Recorder and Veterans Affairs.
Okay. Motion made and seconded to approve those reports. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carried. Okay. We have our liquor license request from the Raceway. Anything there that's, everything's good, right? All right.
I'll make a motion to approve the liquor license for Eddyville Raceway.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve that license application for Eddyville Raceway. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Opposed. Motion carried. Approve 2080 agreements between the sheriff and cities. Russ isn't here, but I think these have been pretty standard every year. Same agreement pretty much as it's been.
Yeah, it's just renewing it for next fiscal year.
These are agreements that we provide. We provide some law enforcement coverage to these two cities in return for some money. I guess I...
You're basically getting reimbursed for the time of the sheriff and...
So...
Move to approve the 2080 agreements for law enforcement between the cities of Fremont and Eddyville.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve these agreements. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carried. Let's go to Troy, accept bids for law enforcement center roof and masonry project. We have we received like five bids on the roof for total. Are we doing the light covers included in that?
Yep.
Okay.
That was the alternate bid.
Alternate bid total of $194,640, and we only received one bid on the masonry for the jail. And that's redoing the outside due to problems over the years we've had. We do have money in the jail fund from leftover from the 1 cent tax that should cover most of this. Hopefully, it's close. So that's where that money's coming from. It's not taxes on. It's not levied on this on property taxes. And that bid is $658,658. So,
I did get a bid for the doors.
That does not include doors. We have doors that are rusting out in the bottom, slowly rusting out, that at some point have to be replaced. The debate is whether to do it now or do it later.
Mike's recommendation was to do it later, just for the fact we don't want to hold the other two jobs up, because there's going to be lead time making these doors. And
And that's something we could maybe do next year, something that could.
He said do it with our security panel or do it as a security project.
Yeah.
Or something.
So.
They were $42,000 for the doors.
That's six doors, right?
Six doors and using our new hinges, but all the old locking systems.
Yeah. So.
It's not much.
The doors are quite expensive. If it's to keep us out or keep them in, but they're expensive doors.
I have a more local company giving me a better quote.
Okay.
But I haven't gotten that.
So. If you are ready, I would entertain a motion.
I make a motion that we accept the bids from the Law Enforcement Center for the roof and masonry project.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve the roof and masonry bids. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. We don't have the, well, where do we want to go? Can't quite do that yet. You want to move through, do some of the secondary road ones here? Dave?
10 minutes.
We may get you out of here pretty quick.
Here we have a.
Let's go first, not time for public hearing, so let's go to the rock trailer. Last meeting we had a discussion about this, thought the used one was the right way, found out the used one wasn't so great, so I think we're gonna change what we decided, kinda what we recommended. We didn't decide, we recommended last meeting to buy that used one. However, that has changed, so.
Yeah, we took a look at that and it has 38,000 miles on it. You know, it's $100 more expensive than a brand new one that has a year's warranty on it. So we're gonna go with the CTS brand and use that, and that way we would have all of our rock trailers replaced, and we'd be good for hopefully in the next 25, because we've gotten about 25 years of use out of both of those.
So I guess the recommendation from the board is that
we trade the 1993 one off.
We trade that one off for that
Jim Hawk,
the new one.
Yeah.
That's my motion.
I second that.
Motion made and seconded to approve that trailer purchase. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. Okay.
We want to just see if we're going to put it in the minutes, or we have to rescind our motion from 2 weeks ago. Or did we cover that?
Well, that was just a recommendation.
It was a recommendation.
It's a recommendation.
Yeah, it was a recommendation. So this puts it final. It's proof, okay. Secure quotes for the tractor and boom mower, first of all.
Well, we have a couple that we're looking at right now through Diamond. If we go with the Massey Ferguson tractor, it would be, which is cheaper, the two options, it's $104,000-some-odd. Wouldn't be delivered till August or September, which would be not getting us very much cut this year for the intersections and stuff. The biggest issue with that is to get the small trees down around the plum bushes and or the bushes around the intersections, so you can see a lot better. Plus, we lost two tractors last year, and this is replacing the one, so it'll pull the roads. Scarify the reclaimer and also the pneumatic roller that we use to do shoulders. So I'm supposed to get something in from John Deere or from Diamond today with the John Deere. They think they might be able to come up with a little better price on theirs, and if it is, we'll bring it back at the next board meeting and we'd have something to make a motion to purchase for the next fiscal year. That was one of the things we had in the budget.
Okay. The next one, the Forester head with excavator.
Well, that's kind of between Ben and myself. We looked at some different things, and I know he was looking at different type of excavators, but what I've got here is information on the three types that we kind of been looking at. It's kind of a... The big thing is whether he gets a grant for it or not, or if we just buy it through secondary roads. This is a FECON model, and it's an inline rotor that cuts and throws things down both ways. But anything that we get to cut along the roadsides, we're going to have some debris flying in different areas. So it's trying to find the machine that has the least amount of discharge. This is the CMAP Denis, which is gives you the operating bars. It's similar to the FECON, a little more expensive. One time I priced a 100 and it was at 60,000, where the FECONs are in the 40s.
40,000,
right?
Ben, you want to come on it? You want to come up, Ben?
Yeah. Pull up the chair.
And this is the other type one, and it's an RMD. It takes a little bit of different oil and stuff, and it has more cutting capacity, but this RDM has also the potential to have it has like a grapple fork, and it comes with a thumb, so you can move trees to wherever you want to go with it. And going to the different type, if you go to like a 20,000 or 24,000 pound excavator, this would be 28. This would be the oil pump gallons per minute on here that they have. So it gives some of these things, and we just need to get started on this. And I didn't know how you had, and Ben's budget had come along for the grant and stuff. But it'd be nice to get something, or at least find something where we can know what we need to look at for a budget amount on this.
How much is the last one?
That one is that's about a $45,000 head as well, but that one has the ability, because it'll have a thumb on it, and it'll have just like a root rake, big claw on the backside, so you can pick trees up and set them where you want to when you top them off. But it does side throw, where it'll throw out more horizontally. But the FECON and the CMAT Denis, they have the same thing. It depends on if you get the gates down and stuff, how far it throws the material. Each one of these takes enough oil per gallon per minute that you have to have enough machine there so you don't overheat the hydraulic oil, or you have to go to a base unit with a power pack on the back that just runs the hydraulics for this cutter.
That one's gonna really throw things, I think.
But I just put that out there so that we kind of got and then we can look at which way you guys think we should go and go from there. I was just trying to get some ideas where we would have the type of cutter, then you size your excavator for the size of hydraulic fluid that you need, and something that's multi-use. So that RDM has a lot of additional uses that can be done. Plus, I said you could pick a tree up and carry it if it's in an area that you don't want to grind it up in and put it someplace, or stack trees along the side for burning.
Are you familiar with all these, Ben?
Never heard of RDM.
Yeah, I talked to you about it the one time I tried to show you that.
Is this the one that...
We talked about SEPI, and that's the one that we're not...
We went up to Powhatchie County last fall.
Yeah.
And this reminds me of that one that really throws things. It's got that horizontal vertical. Mm-hmm.
The thing about this is it throws it to the side, not out the front. So you feed it differently, and it has a deflector shield on it, which keeps it from throwing out such a wide area.
They all throw out to the side. Yeah. Kind of like this.
Yeah, they will. So... I just got some information for hydraulic sizes and different types of cutters. And that way we had some more information out there to look at several different methods. You know, it gives us a different idea. And I've talked to Keokuk, and they have one that's a circular, and they have throwing issues, and they have one that's the other way. And it all depends on how much we can cut with it, how big a tree we can cut with it without going to a monstrous machine, because that's going to cost a lot more.
W- Well.
But this way, at least we've got some information here on the three different types of cutters.
Which why the way, how's this going to be set up? I guess it's my understanding Ben going to be cutting trees with it, right?
That was what we looked at.
That's how I would like it to happen, I guess. I don't know how Marks feel, Marks and Marks, but I know Ben has looked at some stuff. I don't know where you're going with what type of excavator you're getting, if you're still.
You could even look at like the small to mini excavators, like the Cat 70 or 70 G's or the 90 G's, where you could haul them. We've got a trailer on a pickup we could haul that easily on.
Or are you looking at, I know Ben talked about rubber tired. Is that out or is that in? Or
they're going to be a lot more expensive. Everywhere I've talked to, they're a lot more expensive. And the one thing, and I think I talked with Mark about it a little bit, the stability factor when you're trying to cut on slopes and stuff. For safety for the people working it, a track excavator is going to be more safer, more balanced. And so, you can reach more and get into more areas with it than you can with a wheel tire. I'm just trying to look out for the safety of the people that are running it, and if our guys cut with it sometimes too, so that it's a stable machine. Plus, watch our budget numbers on it too, so we can kind of keep the cost down.
The mini excavator is going to have a lot less hydraulic power.
Yeah.
And the reason we've gone away from a skid loader, one of the main reasons, is because of that very reason.
Yeah.
The hydraulic power on a bigger hoe is going to do a lot more work and a lot more efficiently. And so a mini excavator, in my mind, is not, and plus the reach. You're not going to have the reach. 85% of our roads are gravel. Of those, most of them have less than a 20-foot right-of-way. With a 30-foot boom, you can reach almost everything from the road surface. So there's really no reason to be down in the ditch.
But we do have some roads that have wider cross-sections, and you have cedars and stuff growing up into those too. So it's trying to do a combination of them all, but make a machine that's easily movable so that you can be in a lot of different places and still be safe. When you're using, the one thing that I always worried about a rubber tire, you're depending on four outriggers to hold you up, and if the ground's wet or whatever else, you can sink, and then it would put the machine at more of an angle.
Of the counties that have this, the majority of them are on rubber tire hose. I like it for mobility. I don't want to be tied to a trailer and truck all the time.
A lot of this work's going to probably take place in the fall and winter. Yep.
And some in the spring, too, and so when the stuff is still leafless, you can get out there and get some of those cut out of there.
See the wires and see what's what.
Because that's, if you go in the summertime to cut, you're going to have so much foliage that you won't be able to see where fence lines are. But on some of these roads, to get the clear zone established, if it's steeper than a 3-to-1 side slope, you have to go clear at the bottom of the ditch and then out 10 foot or so to establish your clear zone, legal clear zone. And so that would be sometimes where you might have to be down in the ditch as well. I'm just trying to come up and help out and get something on this and look at it and look at some different cutting heads, because they're all going to have their good and bad points. And Decatur has theirs on track hose, and Keokuk has one on each, I think, don't they?
They got one. They just have three rubber tire hose.
They have three rubber.
I can't speak for sure, but I'm pretty sure from what I've
heard. Yeah, they got two. Yeah.
They have three excavator heads.
Three.
Yeah.
Davis County's got a head on a rubber tire excavator.
Well,
I'm not sure what happened to
that. I think move this along. I think you better get your coats on a track and a rubber tire and get your coats on your head that you're looking for, and we'll go from there.
Because
you've applied for the grant, correct?
It's up to $15,000 for the head.
For the head, so that's where I would.
I will know about that.
I mean, we can sit here and talk about this all day, but we're not gonna have anything decided at the end of the day.
Well, I just brought those different type of heads up there and stuff and show you some of the comparison machines. And that's basically all I have on that. Wasn't looking to do anything other than just kind of get this thing going.
All right. Now we need to go into public hearing on ordinance number 26. Dealing with a speed restriction at the Eddyville School.
Motion to go into public hearing.
Support.
Motion made and supported to go into public hearing. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, we are in public hearing. Anybody here to voice concerns about this ordinance? Hearing none. Entertain a motion to close public hearing.
Is there any writing?
Anything?
No.
Oh, she jumped in. Okay.
Motion to move public hearing.
Second.
Motion made and second. Close public hearing. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. And now we need to adopt ordinance number 26.
Well, you can. This is first reading, or you can do a second reading and third reading, or you can waive your second and third reading and adopt it. So however you want to do it.
I guess I would pass the first reading and waive the next two, personally. It's up to you guys.
We can do it next time, just to make sure nobody else wants to say anything, but I'm good either way.
We could. Get out. Maybe somebody will.
Yeah, give some thoughts.
Okay. So we can make a motion to pass it first reading, right? How's that work? We just have
the first reading.
Okay.
And then if you do second reading next time, you can waive the third and adopt.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. You got one more item, recommendation for trucker labor.
Yeah, we have just went out and advertised for that, and we had an excavator position also that was open, but it was not filled from within, so we'll have that going out. That would be filling Daryl Beach's position that he retired or is retiring this week.
Okay.
So we have five people we're going to bring in tomorrow and Friday morning, so we should have that plus the excavator operator selection at the May 2nd meeting.
Okay. Sounds good. Okay. Anything else? We'll go to.
And I think I sent you gentlemen something last night on the meeting that we're having this afternoon. Sent it to Sue as well as a description of the wind turbine area and projects within. So that's all I have, unless you have something for me. We are hopefully going to start G5T next Monday, weather permitting. It's still at least a four-week project to get done. When they get started, they can go every day. We just got our bids in, got the bid in yesterday for the T65 project. We got to get clearance and stuff from the state, but it did come in under our estimate. So we'd be looking for approval and signing that at the May 2nd meeting as
okay.
well.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave.
All right, Brad, we're going to get you. You have a limited time, so you only get a half hour.
Well, don't tell me, I only get maybe 5 minutes. It'll take longer than 5 minutes. It always does.
We just lost our crowd.
What was wrong with the subject?
Nobody wants to hear about it.
I want to complain about it, though.
You need to start with the inclusion of the.
Yeah, we got this item here, approval inclusion guidelines, Mahaska County Health Plan, the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act compliance.
I'm glad you put it on the agenda. That's great, because I sent it off to Sue and said, what has happened is the Parity Act, when it first came out, everybody had an interpretation of what it read and what it said. Well, over time, Walmart kind of takes a little bit of step back, and then what they've discovered, that they feel that it would be in the best interest of all their plans to update their Mental Health Parity Act of all their plans, and Mahaska County's is one of those that needs to be, in their opinion, needs to be updated and so forth. And it would go back retro to 7-1. It wouldn't affect anybody in claims purposes. It's just something that I think, it's just some little tweak that needs to be put in there. And I am sending it to you and recommending that you do approve that. And all it does is takes, it just takes you to approve it and then just send us an email, reply to the email I sent Sue, and then it'll go into effect retro back to 7-1.
What are the nuts and bolts?
It's just a little tiny cotter pin that's going in, and really what's doing is just tightening it up a little bit more. It's to the benefit of the employee and not to the benefit of the county.
Right. So what's the Equity Act? What's the Addiction Equity Act compliance?
Did you send that out to everybody?
Yeah. I think everybody got this. Shows what it's gonna.
What changes, I guess.
Well, they're just gonna change the SBC of the wording. And the claims will be adjudicated through a payment funding process in the same manner as any other claim. Corrected, it was administered differently, and now it's being more adjudicated within the thing. It doesn't make it so stringent for the employee. It makes it a lot more neat when they get into their mental health and their so forth. But it isn't right now. It's not, the wording is not in compliance. So they're changing the wording of compliance to get it moving. What's it going to affect? Right now, if you go backwards, it didn't affect anything. If you go back even prior to checked in 2016, it didn't affect anybody. So, but it's an added benefit. So, but I didn't bring the exact SBC of what the wording would be at all.
I picked one sentence out of there. Basically, the sentence I thought says impacts how services should be classified and tested. That's the main thing I caught out.
So that would be the. Yeah. Is that a question?
No, that was a statement. Just a summary of what I gathered out of it. It's basically just going to change how things are coded wherever, just for the classification of.
Correct. I guess to summarize it, it's to the benefit of the employee and as a fiduciary of the supervisors, you probably need to be in compliance. I mean, it's just, I didn't bring the actual act. I apologize. I can get that to you if you want that.
Make a motion that we approve the inclusion of guidelines in Mahaska County Employee Health Plan for the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act compliance.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to approve this inclusion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Opposed? Motion carried. Now we go to the renewal.
Yep. All right. I promise I'm not the one that brought the weather, because it seems like every time I come down here there's some kind of weather transition. So it was raining and going to be snowing when I get back to the morning. So, the tabs, the areas we're going to cover just quickly, routine again, like we've always done. Section 1 talks about the life and AD&D voluntary, the specific loss report, and we go through the provider analysis. Then the annualized cost projection for 2017-18 plan year, medical renewal analysis, ASO dental and vision renewal, COBRA administration renewal discussion. I do have a few items that I need to discuss with you in regards to the upcoming year, and then the group medical history as well. It's always on there. Let's see, Mark, this is the first time you've been through with the history?
Mm,
Probably the second.
No, this is second. Your second. So
no,
you would have
he's all right.
So you're from the, everybody here, this is...
He's got it all figured out. Okay.
All right. I guess
working on it.
So, we go to tab one, the life insurance. We negotiated back in 17 to get that rate held to 2019. So there's no change on that. So nothing changed on that at all. All the employees who participate, the next page, all the employees who participate in the voluntary life product, there's no change on that. Also, we negotiated that along with the life to get that held till 2019. So there's no change in any of those benefits. One, no change to the employees of the voluntary, and no change to the county of the life insurance. Any questions on those two programs? All right, the next page is we're getting into the medical portion of it. This gives you an idea of where you're at. As of March 31st, we don't get the reports to the end of the month, so all we have is March. What we're showing here is your specific levels at 50,000. What we're showing here is anything that's at 50%. And we have four of them that have exceeded that. One at 18,000 plus, one at 11,000, 219, one at 44, 61, and the other one at 22, slightly over the 50. Don't know a lot about what's going to happen with the ones in the future. More than likely, there's probably another, there's one in there that probably is going to go over a little bit. Where these numbers really come into play, it's, you know, four specifics over 50, over your specific amount isn't that bad. It's when you start seeing six and seven and eight of those on there. You've had a high claim year, but you haven't had. It's all been under the 50. It's not been. It's a bunch of stuff under it. And then also, we'll talk about the prescription as well. So there's a couple things in there we'll talk about as we go along. But we'll refer back to this because I do have numbers on the renewal in there for going to a 50,000 specific. And I know that we used to, when was it, 3 years ago, 2 years ago, we went from a 45 to a 50,
yeah.
Because economically it made a lot of sense. And I think when we look at the 55s this time around, it may not make sense. So we'll talk. But we'll be able to refer back to this page, which helps us make that decision. Okay. The next page is the what we always refer to as the loss ratio report. It's really where the kind of analyzes where you are in comparison to what you insure versus what you actually paid out. Going through the procedure again, really we take the single factors of 568.50 and the family factors at 1421.25, and then every month we times it by the number of singles and the number of families, and we come up with a number, and then that number is totaled down to the bottom. Now, as you notice here, we got 9 months total, and then what we do is we take the 9 months total and divide it by 9 and times it by 12, and that's how we get the annualized down to the bottom. But as we speak today, if you look at the medical claims minus any of the specifics we talked about earlier, just a little bit ago, you're sitting at about 82% of your attachment point. Now, and Willie shared this since way back when we started here, but if you can get that number at anywhere from 75 to 80, that's where the insurance company expected it to be. When they calculate the rates out, they think that that's about where you're going to be. Well, you're right there. Even though you've had a bad year. Now, remember, we've talked about this. In the past 3 or 4 years, you've had really good years. And fortunate enough, you had enough put aside that it's able to do. But now it is come time where it's starting to catch up a little bit. So that being said, you're sitting at 80%. I don't feel that that's bad. If that number starts getting to 85 to 90, then we've got an issue. That we got some things we need to start looking at. But as of right now, you remember, you got a rich plan, very rich plan. The average person going to an employer right here in town would not have this rich a plan. So they'd be fortunate enough. And I don't think there's a lot of compensation or a lot of their pay they got to pay out of it either. So it's a good plan. And what happens when you have a rich plan, you're going to have a lot of higher claims because people aren't going to take as much ownership to it. There's not any, as they say, bite in the game. They're just, insurance didn't pay for it, insurance didn't pay for it. Well, when you have a benefit that the county has and so forth. Now, again, I'm not trying to say that Mahaska County's is doing great. This is true with a lot of counties. I mean, but I'm starting to see that the contribution levels are going up. and the benefits aren't as rich. We're starting to see that because now it's coming. It's getting, and because medical inflation has gotten starting to really get high. I also in there put in your dental. Now, what I want you to note here, as of the first 9 months, it's $74,842.61. Last year, for the full 12 months, last year was $76,90. Now, everybody knows probably why that's gotten that way. You're on track to be $99,000, close to $100,000. Why? We increased the benefit. We did that last year. So, two things happen when you do that. You increase your claims, but you also increase your administration. So you have more claims going back and forth. So we're going to talk about the dental renewal as well on the ASO, because what's happening here is we're seeing a lot more activity. So there's a lot more work. So a lot more work means administration and so forth. So a vision, you didn't make much change. So you're right at what you were last year. It's on track of 14,815 and it's 13,181. That's nothing. That doesn't. It's going up, but I think that's trend. That's just the cost of eye care and claims. So. But just to summarize, your dental claims are up because of the benefit being richer this year, and your medical claims are just creeping just because it's that time. Where, you know, I mean, everybody's heard this, me tell this, that in 10 years, you're going to have two great years and two bad years, and in between is where it all makes sense on self-funding, and everybody usually comes out ahead on self-funding. So any questions on that report, anybody? All right. Let's just dissect just a little bit, just kind of let you know where you're. Now, these are Mahaska County's claims that they paid. The pharmacy is your biggest. 20% of your claims are coming from your pharmacy. That is high. And I think that's what we talked about last time, about putting in a different RX utilization, and we'll talk about that later on. But that's one of the biggest things. That number, it will continue to increase. It'll be bigger. Now, we've got some people that are going to the hospital, so usually when people go to the hospital, it goes into prescription, but that isn't what's happening on your medical plan when you dive into the prescription program, into your prescriptions. There's a little bit different situation going on there. Surprisingly, I was somewhat surprised that a lot of the claims from a hospital standpoint, it's coming from Mahaska County. Smaller towns, you know, you see it going to the bigger cities. So, Mercy. A lot of people are going locally here, so one person did go to Mayo Clinic, and we got a couple physicians locally. But the big number that just jumps out, should jump out at you, is that pharmacy, 20%. And that, I will tell you that, by the end of the year, based on what's out there right now, that number probably will end up being a bigger number. Any questions on that page?
You're talking bigger than 20% or bigger than 210?
Both.
Okay. Yeah, that's true. They go parallel. Yeah.
That number, I can assure you, that's easy. That number, 210, will probably be another $18,000 in 3 months. And unless we have a bunch of hospital visits coming up that's ongoing, I just think that number's big. Any questions on any of that page?
What would a healthy plan look like?
Well, that number there would probably be 15 to 16.
Okay.
But we're talking a big number. So when you talk about percentage wise, I mean, if you pull down your, let's just back in here. It's really not so much the percentage, it's the dollar amount that's going through and what you could do with the pharmacy. I guess that's really the focus. Let's assume we had two or three people. We saw four people on there that probably have gone to the hospital, and maybe a couple more. Then if we have more increase in hospital visits, there isn't a lot you can do with that other than figure out a way to get the hospital not to charge so much. Okay, that's really how you control that cost. But the pharmacy, the way your plan is set up, that number will continue to go up based on some data that I'm seeing inside the plan. So. And I think we're going to talk about prescriptions in a little bit. So, any questions on that page?
What would factor into the all others? I mean, that's more than everything you have broken out.
Well, that adds up to a lot of all claims under $7,000. The exact amount, I mean, we could have put could have, I mean, I don't know where we used to do 15, and then it got so small that we didn't even do it. Now, there might be 10 more claims that amounted to $6,000. They're not the ones that are costing your plan. It's the larger claims and the pharmacy. And it's not Mahaska County. It's every plan you talk about. It's that top 10 claims is where it's where the majority of the claims are coming from. But, you know, your hospital visits haven't been that bad. $122,000 when you're talking $1 million, that's not, that's only, mm-hmm. that's less than 10%. That's 10, you know, a little over 10%. That's not bad at all. That's that pharmacy. So, if you want that list, I can get that for you.
I was just wondering what else would be factored in.
Cause yeah, there's
just,
a lot.
It's I mean, all it lumped together.
Take, it doesn't take much anymore.
It's the majority of our total expenses.
Right,
so.
Right. It when you got 130 people plus their dependents using the claims, that doesn't take much to add all that up. Your frequency, you know, your frequency to office visits or whatever.
That's just a typical, like, $180.
It is so typical. It is so typical. Okay. It's a good question, but anymore, it doesn't take much to spend, pay $7,000 for or $6,000 for anything you walk in and walk into that hospital. Mm-hmm. That's what it costs. Mm-hmm. Now, there are ways to reduce that. That's another day of education of the Board of Supervisors, to sit down with them and kind of educate them what we can do also to control those costs. But your issue is not there. Your issue is in another place. Okay? And if you want the claims, I can get it for you, Mark.
No, it's okay.
Okay.
I was just wondering. No,
that's a good question. It does. You're like one. But it's atypical. All right. The next page is just to let you know the provider savings. What you're getting from the blue card. Now, I hope everybody remembers the blue card. And what the blue card is, remember here we have Mayo Clinic. Some of that's Mayo Clinic. See that? $10,350. It's off a little bit. But if you turn that, see, it's $10,407. You go back to the page before, it's $10,315. The system, there might have been a couple dollars that came through later, but you get the idea. That's Mayo Clinic. Okay, so whatever it was, they got a 64% savings on the account. Classic Blue would be your PPO plan you have here in Iowa. Now, I really want everybody, we've always talked about discounts. But discounts aren't always what they lead you to believe. Sometimes discounts are just a number to make people think that they got a heck of a discount. Okay. It'd be like this: if you went to a store and you went in there last week and it was for $100. And then tomorrow they said, and you went in, or 6 months later you went in there and they said it was $150, but we're going to sell it to you for $80. So from there to there, that seems like a big discount, but you're really not getting that big a discount. That's kind of what happens in the health insurance industry. We don't know. The thing about healthcare today is you and I, it's one of the only things we go to, we have today, that we don't know what the initial price is. We have no idea. Mm-hmm. It's locked up in a box called a master charger at a hospital. And they all have this schedule. And it's locked in keys and so forth. You don't know what that charge is. The insurance company probably does a little bit. They tell them a little bit about it, but really don't know. So I like it's always been, but and the reason I bring this up, because when we originally went, when you switched to this plan, when you went from where you were at before to where you're at today with Blue Cross Blue Shield, 10 years ago or even 9 or 8 years ago, discounts were a big thing because the number wasn't that big. Well, now when this number gets so big, that discount means a lot more. So today we have to address more about what is discounts really the real thing, or how do we address the discounts? And again, I don't want to get into that today, but I do want to address something with you. Discounts are a little bit of, aren't really what they want you to believe, okay? Because
they marked her up first. And
I didn't say that. You did. Okay, well, so.
And that's what it appears.
And same thing with prescriptions. Same thing's happening with prescriptions. There's no secret why UnitedHealthcare, Cigna, Aetna and some of the Blues have made profits are up since 2010. What happened in 2010? Anybody remember? Obamacare.
Obamacare.
Why are they making 600% more? Why is their stock up 600%? Why are pharmaceuticals stocks up that far? There's a reason for that. Because there was a little bit of lobbying going on over there in Washington, D.C. Guess who the biggest lobbyists are in Washington, D.C.? The medical.
Medical.
Over law and everything else. So, a little education here today. So, anyway. So, the total on that is $1,153,000 total adjusted charges. So, any questions on that page?
No.
Didn't want to.
Where'd you say that million?
I add the two together. The okay. 258 and 892 add up to $1,151,332.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay.
The two columns.
Okay. All right. All right, the next page is the annual, just kind of projecting things. You're on track for paying about $250,000 of reinsurance premium. Your PPO access fees, and here's the other thing that's funny, is not only do you pay for that discount, you got to pay for the discount. So there's that PPO access fee you got to pay. It's $6.95 an employee per month. So that's in there. And then the administration and the utilization on the medical and the PBM, okay? So that's on track for $65,000. And as I indicated here, I'm putting in the dental in there. It's not in these numbers, but just note the annualized for dental is projected 99, which I told you earlier, and the vision's at 14. The medical, if you go back to the report, it was at $1,044,000. Then we got some specific reimbursement. Then we had a few $2.40 that wasn't covered by the plan at all. When you're talking $1 million, $2.40 isn't—it's kind of—I don't even know why they put it in there, but it's there. You did get some rebates, by the way, for the first, second, third quarter. You've gotten $16,000 back to the plan. Zeus—they've showed up on the invoice and so forth. They come back. What some employers do with those, which most employers do, they hold on to them and then turn around and put them back into the plan's cost to save the employees. Some employers say here's the amount back, but no, we turn around and put it back. So you can do whatever you want with those, but I think in the years past when the rebates came in, because of the way that you've got such a rich plan, I think you just put it back into adjudicating the claim, making sure the claims cost and the premium for the employee doesn't go up. So we're sitting at and annualize that, you're probably on track for getting a $21,350 total rebate. They are supposed to give, the ACA was required you to give all that kickback now, so you're getting a little bit more than, if you go back and look at track record, there wasn't as much. Quite honestly, there probably should be double that, but that's all that's coming in. Okay, so not including the rebates, your cost right now, you've spent about $1,007,000. That doesn't include the employee's contribution, but it does include the premium and the medical claims that the county's paid. So if we annualize that, you're on track for $1,343,164 for the total medical cost. Your attachment point, as I said, was $1,622,000, so there's that 82%, a little bit over, but that's fine. I'm fine with that. So if you take the 250 and the 65 and then put in the rebates, projected your total is going to is on track for $1,000,000, is that right? $1,637,000 versus the maximum could have been $1,916,000. The biggie there really is not the administration costs, it's the claims that are going through, and the claims include prescription and medical. Okay? Any questions on that? Remember, this page does not include employee contributions. It does include the county's expenses. So, I mean, again, obviously the employee's paying for part of some of it, I think, if I don't remember. I think we talked about that sewer water reserves. Okay. The first page, tab 6, we're talking about the renewal. Now, remember what we do this, we divide this up into, we're really going forward, we want to talk about the current enrollment. We don't want to talk about the average, but these numbers on the left side should add up to pretty much what the page before did. But what we want to do is, right now you had, last year you averaged 36 employee singles and 81 families. Right now you have 36 and 82. That could change next month, but we have to take the picture when it was. So at a $50,000 specific, your current premium, Wellmark's administrative costs are going up 3.9%. That comes from $38.58 for the claims administration to $40.40. They're not going to charge any additional for the PBM fee, which I don't know what that's for, but that's what they charge. That they say that's what their feed, that's what they're electronically, how they can feed the numbers in is what they're telling me. I go to other PBMs and they don't charge it, but anyway, that's what it is. And then the access fee, that's that. That's the $6.95 you pay for that discount. You pay for a discount, okay? So when you go into the drugstore or go into the local store here, they're going to give you a discount. And then they say, before I get done charging you, you're going to have to pay another additional amount because I gave you a discount. So that's what that's in there for, okay? So the overall cost is 3.9%. The surprising thing about this is that your reinsurance premium did not change much. Only went up 2.34%. It went from $88.40 to $91.10. Your family went from $205.99 to $209.77. And the aggregate reinsurance, that $50,000, the attachment point you're paying for, did not go up. So the reinsurance and the reinsurance went up 1.93%, and their cost went up 2.34%. Now, where you really get into it, they think, and remember we talked about when they calculate the numbers on what they think the aggregate attachment point is, remember, everybody remember that 125%? If they expect it to be X, which is the expected, right there, they expect next year that your claims will be $1,485,000. Remember, they projected last year to be $1,315,000. It's the same number we talked about earlier about the 80%. If you look at that number, Walmart's going to increase that by almost 13%. And a lot of it has to do because your claims are higher, because they see what's there and going to go forward. But if you were going to be fully insured, you'd look at it and go, you know, based on our year we had, 12.95% increase, that's not that bad when you see what you've had for claims last year. But your fixed cost is really the portion you actually have to pay for, the aggregate factor. They expect your claims to go up by $100,000+. Whether it will be or not, or will it be over, will it be under, that's why self-funding is, there is a risk on that. Any questions on that, the renewal? Anybody? All right. Okay. The next page are the alternates. Now, in our last meeting, to get together, Mark had asked that we look around, shop the market, okay, which we did. That's option alternate number 3. We'll get to that in a second. But I wanted to let you know that is alternate 3. Alternate 3 is our option. If you, option 1 and 2, the difference between option 1 and 2 are this. If we put in, we talked about this last time, if you put in that drug card program, that RX utilization management review with Walmart, you put that in, they're going to drop everything else. Fixed costs are the same all the way across. Doesn't matter. First two. Alternates 1 and 2, the fixed costs are the same. Nothing changes. It's just your claims. Look at that 2.34. Doesn't matter. It's on the same. Nothing changed. The only thing that changes is aggregate factors. Blue Cross Blue Shield feels that if you switch to the RX management, which I have in your packet, which is on the side. If you wouldn't mind getting that out, that would probably help. It's right here. It's called Pharmacy Benefit Program Utilization Management Report. Okay? And if you go to what's all entailed with this, right? The utilization management portion, if you go to page 2, Everybody have this up? This one right here, page two. Okay? Page two. There'll be opioid management programs, which you don't have now. And we have been hearing this on the news so bad that it's a serious situation out there right now with opioid overdose. So that will manage the opioid management program. They'll also include prospective drug utilization review. I'm going to skip that one and come back to that. The other ones, the only one that's really going to affect your employees is going to be that third, prospective drug utilization review. We'll come back to that in a second. But the other bullets aren't really going to come into play. The concurrent drug utilization review, the retrospective drug utilization review programs, quantity limits. You know, they're going to put that in. I don't think you have an issue with, doesn't appear that you've got any employees that are getting massive quantities. That's going to show up more on the opioid management and then prior auth, which everybody has done in the past. So if you implement that, but the thing about what's going to happen, the prospective drug utilization review, the biggest thing that's going to affect your employees is in the middle of that paragraph, there's a word contingent therapy. Everybody see that? It's the third sentence, third line. It says at the end, contingency therapy. That's the same thing as step therapy. Step therapy means that if your employee is not taking a generic drug and a generic is available, they're going to have to go through step therapy, meaning they're going to have to try the generic. If they don't use the generic, then they'll have to pay the difference between the generic and what they're paying. That's going to be the biggest thing. Now, if you implement this, Wellmark will allow you to grandfather it, meaning anybody that has had this medication, we can go back 6 months, and you'd say that anybody that was already on one of these things that they feel we're grandfathering them. You could do that. Okay, that's an option. Do I recommend it? Not. Yes, I would, because I see what the prescriptions that are being taken. All right. That's going to be the biggest one. The step therapy. People are going to have to be. They will be notified by Wellmark that you're taking this drug. We're having the step therapy. You can have it go into effect July 1st, or you could have it go into effect in August, September if you implement it. It doesn't have to go into effect on July 1st. You may want to give your employee, you know, get the letter in the mail, so forth. Give your employees time to adjust to it. All right? I will tell you this. I think I told this last time. There's a medication that somebody's taking that will cost the county close to $70,000 this year, okay? And it's available in a generic, and they're not taking generic. And it's not in the hospital claims. It's in the pharmacies, okay? I'm not picking on that person. I'm not. If there was six of them, if there wasn't any, I'd let you know that this is a story I'll tell, that this is what's happening out there today. The drug that they're taking was not available in generic in October. So they probably don't even know it's available in generic. You're allowing them to go to the pharmacy and just fill the prescription like the doctor said. Hey, does it matter which one you're taking? No. Okay, I'll put you on this one. So it's a... Now, the other thing, too, on the quote that I have back here that we pointed out, that there's a quote, there's another one here. It's called, below it, it says, RX utility program apply with dispenses written. Now, this one, this key word, it's also, you may have heard it before, DAW, dispense as written. If the doctor... In this case, I don't know if that's the case, but if the doctor does say DAW, then they don't. If you just did option number alternate two and implemented that program, the DAW still would apply. So that right now you do not have the standard language on dispenses written. Most of the plans today say that even though it's dispenses written, we're going to fall back to this utilization program. All right. So if you review alternate two, then it would also have the utilization. Now, dispense as written. I have a little bit of information on the back side here, and also the step therapy. Dispense as written, Wellmark designs their pharmacy benefits so that the member's first option when filling a prescription is to preserve generic when available. Although they do not mandate generic substitution, the dispense as written plan designs incent members to choose generic. In the event a member chooses brand over generic, Wellmark will only reimburse what we would have paid for the generic, thus passing any additional cost on. So, if you do the step, if you do the first option, like I said, with the UR program, and the doctor writes DAW, it's null and void, okay? But if you take out the DAW, you put in the DAW standard, really, the DAW doesn't override the UR program under the step therapy does. What I don't know is if that's the case in the situation. You have three medications in your top 20, I think 15, that could get generics, but you have the one that I was referring. The other two are not. It's the bigger ones that are costing. But again, in their defense, if it went into effect in October, generic came out, well, if they didn't know it and they're still in this drug and the county's still paying for it, well, I mean, every one of you would just continue to get that prescription, wouldn't you? I mean, you would, unless you knew that now there is a generic available, and the plan says that I need to look at step therapy and go through that. So, so what difference does it make? It saves. Well, Wellmark thinks that you will save if you take the difference between the, if you go to the expected, go back to, see where it says 1,452,627.60? Anybody see that number? Go back to the first blue page right after it. Which alternate page? One. Alternate one. Come down to the bottom where it says expected. 1,452,627. See that number? Expected. 1,452,627. Everybody see that? The renewal was 1,485,562. So Wellmark thinks that if you implement this program, you're going to save $32,000. That's what they, and that's, and remember what I told you, if you take the 66, what I just said, or 70, and they bring it down, this claim down, you're going to be under that specific amount, it's going to get it down to 33,000. You're going to save, just on that one claim, a lot of money. And the next one, and the next one. Your plan is one of a few that does not have that in here. So, questions?
Click on the page 4 of the pharmacy utilization program.
Yep.
The quantity limitations.
Yep.
Can you explain that one a little bit?
Well, they're going to say that if somebody's getting, it's really going to fall back. It's really an issue with the opioid. Somebody's getting too much. And that's what the quantity limit is. They're going to say, wait a minute, based on this coming in, you're getting too much. And that's what's going on here. This really is, this.
They have a separate section for the opioid. But
I know that. They do. But here I will tell you this. What the quantity limit's always been there.
Okay.
They just added the opioid.
Okay.
So take out the opioid and you get somebody that's on some kind of medication that's, they're overdose. There's too much here going on.
There's a...
Well, a doctor, it's protecting you from the doctor giving it out. I mean, for all you know, that there's somebody getting a prescription and then they're turning around and, I don't say this is happening, but it does happen where the doctor will prescribe and guess what's happening with this person? The doctor and the employee are in together and they're selling it on the open market. So that's what they're controlling, Mark. They just don't want somebody... Now, remember, based on this treatment... You've exceeded what you should be a quantity. And it's not the Almighty standing in front of there going, we're done. There's a little bit of interaction going on here with the provider and the insurance company. I think it's what, you know, you see one right on there. There's one right on there. The Viagra's one right there. That's a good example. People are getting it for the physician and getting mass quantities of it. What are they doing with it? You can sell it on the internet.
Sell it to somebody else.
On the open market. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just a good example of what I didn't want to go that far with it,
yeah.
But that's a good
one. We had an insurance meeting, and you had made a couple of recommendations a couple of years ago, and there are people that get, like, just for example, something that they take, something they're going to take for the rest of their life, and they get 90-day prescriptions. And so if they're only paying the copay for one, for a 30-day supply, or for a 90-day supply once,
yeah,
and then that would triple it, if we,
right.
If
that,
we
would, that would
it
not
to
be
30
a, that would not be a quantity issue.
Okay. Okay.
The quantity issue is if that person, the system says, wait a minute, you're getting a 90-day supply, that's okay, but how many a 90-day supply are you getting? I mean, are you
don't
getting,
come back,
if it should be only one 90-day,
one,
you should get 90 pills, and you're getting 180 pills, that's time out. There's something going on there.
Okay.
It's not on the 90-day limit. It's
right.
On the quantity that you're getting in that 90 days, or the quantity you're getting in the 30, or the quantity you're getting
okay.
in the 60.
So I'm saying, this should last you at least 90 days. And if you
we're not going to get rid of that,
okay.
No. But, Cialis, Viagra, all these, that's what, believe it or not, how are these people selling on the market? Open, wide open market, how's that happening? Well, that's what's going on. The doctor's prescribing it. The person's going out and selling it on the internet. Go ahead.
Do you think this, we implement this, does this affect our union?
You'll have to talk to the union whether they feel that that's a benefit change to your employees.
Because I'm supposed to call Galloway, and I figured I'd wait till I understood what was going on here.
Yeah.
And then,
yeah.
And we'll discuss
what
that.
What I would do is if you're hesitant because of the union, I was hoping that that had been discussed already, but let's do this. I would suggest, because of what you just said, let's put, if you're okay with the renewal, let's keep it the way it is. But I'm going to keep pounding on this one.
Because they've got 1 year left on the current contract. And
yeah,
then, and
so
then
maybe that's the time you put it in.
And that without causing a furor.
I don't want anybody else to walk in back in here and go, wait a minute, that guy's not doing his job.
Yeah.
Okay? I mean, my job is to represent the county. It's not to represent, I like the employees, I love them, they're great people, I'm sure. But my job is to take care of you guys and to make sure you're doing your fiduciary responsibility. And your job is to take care of the plan. So, Willie, I 100% agree with what you just said. I would, if it was me, I really wasn't here about what you should pick those other two. I wanted you to see what the difference was.
Yeah.
Okay? And I think Mark brought that up last time. What is it? Did you not? I think you did. You brought up, said, what is it going to look like for a cost? Well, my answer was, that's not a good answer. Well, let's see what it's going to be. Okay? So, if it was me, and I'm looking at this plan, I'd take the renewal, not any of these alternates. However, I did want to show you alternate three. I didn't want you to forget that one. If you went to another third-party administrator, Cypress, they have offices in Appleton, Wisconsin, Denver, Colorado, Oregon, and Omaha. So they're a well-reputable third-party administrator. They're not just some, they are a reputable, they're one of the bigger ones in the country. So what I did is I got market from them. And obviously their administrative costs are less, which is interesting. Look at the network fee, $5. It's Midland's Choice who you're using, Midland's Choice PPO network. You pretty much would cover most of the state of Iowa. So look at that, you're going, whoa, that's 17% under. However, the reinsurance premium's higher. It's $175,000 more. All right, now this is where it really makes a big difference. Those are fixed costs. So you're sitting there going, I don't want to pay more money for that. But I want everybody to understand something. I brought it up earlier, that when you have a Wellmark, a Cigna, United Healthcare, and Aetna, they have an auto adjudication system. What they do is somebody's in the hospital, worker, here's the code, they put the code in and auto adjudicate. And that's it. There's no auditing going on. There's no, if there's errors, if anybody watched, read the paper lately, there was an article in the paper about error, I mean, maybe a month ago or so, about medical errors that are happening out there. You don't know how much of this, of your plan, there's errors on. You have no idea. Mm-hmm. It was auto-adjudicated. Plus you got a discount. Well, okay, we know, we've talked about that. What Midland's Choice is, it's an independent PPO, which covers most of the majority of the doctors in the state of Iowa and hospitals. But they allow the third-party administrator to go in and audit each claim down to $2,500. What they have found, 15 to 20% of those claims have been either coded wrong, errors, whatever. So if you take that 1465, that's not it, and you take off, you times that by 10 to 15%, that's about, let's just say 10%, that's $146,000. Well, there's your 107. You're getting close. I'm saying this quote is not I wouldn't do it. But I want you to understand that when you go to another outside vendor who's going to give you the discounts, they also allow somebody to come in and audit their claims. The big ones don't. Blue Cross, United Healthcare, that's part of the deal. If you're going to take our PPO, you stay away. Or if you do with Midland's Choice, one of these private, they will allow that. There's TPAs will tell you that if you go in and audit their claims, the PPO network is going to come in to say no, or at no, or are going to do a cease and desist. So they can't adjudicate. They can't go in and audit the claims. Now Wellmark says that they do their own. Yeah, they do, but theirs is on large dollars, not on these $6,000 claims. Now Mark brought it up. What's below this line? Believe it or not, that's where most of the errors are coming in, or audit, or in this the smaller amounts, and they add up. So anyway. But I'm not recommending alternate three. I don't think you're ready for that. But just to keep that in mind, maybe more of an educational. Okay, any questions on that? The next page, 55, the one next blue one, is if you want to go to a $55,000 specific. You would save about $12,595 if you, we can go through all this, but your renewal is $257,649 for fixed cost. I'm writing these down for you so you don't have to refer back. But your renewal, your $50,000K, your fixed total reinsurance costs are $257,649. Okay? Write that number down. $257 at the bottom. $257,649. That's your reinsurance renewal cost. With the $50,000, it's $245,000, as you see right here. $245,054. Okay? See that number up there? Wellmark, annual reinsurance premium. Under alternate four, it says $245,054. See that number, everybody? So if you subtract those two numbers, the first one I gave you and that number, you come up with $12,595. All right. Now, let's go back and look at tab two. Now, you have four claims that have gone over the 50, okay? So if you change it to a 55, tab two, Willie.
All right, yeah, I'm with you.
If you go to 55, the first claim is going to cost you, if you just take the same thing and apply it for next year, you're going to spend, that's $5,000 more for the first one. You're going to pay $5,000 more for that one. Next one, you're going to pay $4,004 for that one, and you're going to pay $2,600 more, okay, if you go to a 55. Well, that already exceeds the savings of $12,595.
Yeah.
I know you've always asked for it, and you were on a 45. It made sense at 50. I will tell you this. I think 50 is about where you need to be. I don't think you want to start messing with that because there isn't any savings to do it. Any questions on that? I don't do it.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead. All right, what page are you on?
Page tab 6.
Okay, tab 6, yep.
The alternate that you went
number
through.
Number 6?
Yep. So the, is this alternate six all insurance the same?
Yep.
All same coverages?
Yep. All you did was change the utilization on the claim at the bottom. See at the bottom? That these are the difference. You're getting a $55,000 and everybody's cost is the same. The only difference is the ag factors. Boom, boom, boom. And this one was no change your current plan. This one's putting in an RX program. This is putting in the RX and the DAW. Okay. That's the difference between those three.
Okay.
I don't know how else to present that. I mean, it's about the best way I can do it. Okay?
On this one here.
What page you on now? Tab 6?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So this other, you know, if you went with the other PPO,
right.
Does this all insurance coverage is the same that we have with Walmart? Everything's the same?
Yeah, the only thing you're changing is those things at the bottom. That's it.
Okay.
That's all you're changing.
So this is a little bit more as far as this is.
You should have, it should be less. They're less.
And you have the potential to save another $146,000 if it's 10% what they say, and then they can audit it.
Right.
Then why wouldn't you recommend that?
Why wouldn't we what?
Why would you not recommend this other plan then?
Go to a 55? That's 55. Oh.
This is for the other outside provider.
Oh, you're on tab.
I think I'm in 6. Yeah, I'm in 6.
You're on 6, but you're on the second page. Okay. Got your alternate 3? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Why would I not recommend it? Because you got to go to the union to find out if you can put the RX utilization in the DAW.
This is with the...
These are the costs for with the RX DAW. This is just with the RX utilization management. This is no change.
Okay.
But I don't think you. I'm not recommending you make the switch on that yet. I don't. I think you got to go to the union. But I was like I said, just in case you had talked to the union already and had gotten approved, then you had it. That's why I wanted. And plus, now you can go to the. I don't know. You asked for what the numbers look like. Remember, this is a 50. This is no change. Okay? RX. Okay, I'm sorry. This is with the RX, this is with that, and that's with that.
Okay.
This one here, this is Cypress. And you're losing your see the fixed cost there? 50.
Yep.
326. Well, I don't make sense. And I said the only way you're going to make it come out ahead on this is if we take that number, and that number ends up being
10%.
The difference between those two is what you're going to have to save. And I don't know that it's there yet. I don't think I would make that change. But I just wanted you to know that.
You got to make up $175,000.
Yeah, you got to make up $175,000 on the claims for the audit. That's exactly. Yeah, perfect, Mark. That's right. I don't see the numbers. If this number up here was 326, or I'm sorry, 326, and let's say the alternate was 400,000, well, then we'd have to do some educating here. Then we'd have to really consider it. Then there's $75,000 that you're going to do. So, does that make sense, mm-hmm. everybody?
Yeah.
I totally get it. This stuff can be, but I hope that we try to make this as... Is better, and Lindsay put in the blue pages to kind of give you an idea. But again, if you make no changes, it's the first one on page after tab 6, first one. That's it, where it says renewal. You got to go back a little bit farther. Mark, are you looking? Are you?
Oh, back on page 2?
Go first thing right after right there. This is the one, if you don't make any changes, you want to accept the renewal, and you don't want to go to a $55,000, right there is it. That's it.
That's on 6, right?
It says renewal, and it's current.
Yes,
nope. Keep going. It's right. Put a star above that one. That's the one, right there. Nope. Next one. Right there. That's the one. The one on the right. That's the renewal. Fixed costs went up 2.34, but their aggregate factors went up 12.95. Those are the numbers with no RX changes at all. But it does include the mental health, and it does cover the other... that's already in there. The mental health, I told them to quote that. Unless you turn around and tell me you didn't want to do it, then I got to turn around and get... but it all is going to change the ag factor. So it does have those changes in it. All right. Any questions on the medical renewal? How are we doing? Well, I got winded, didn't I? Told you. All right. Last page. We're getting close. Deb, I know. I told you. I'm over. I know that, but I.
Okay.
You're going to say it was worth it.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't want you to get in trouble with the city.
Well, they're. I'll blame it on.
Blame it on me.
I'll blame it on Sue. How's that? All right. You'll know better than that. Okay. Delta Dental. Here, let me. Can you mind if I? You mind if I?
No, take care of it.
Communicate over there.
That's good.
I'm gonna have to. You don't mind.
No, that's wise.
They'll figure that out. Okay, the next one is the ASO Dental. Because administration now, one thing I didn't care for with Emeritus on their dental. They put heavier emphasis on, even though it's going up 0.29 per 29 cents to administer. It's going from 548 to 577. And they also projected there's your 105,000. They think it's going to be 105 next year for the next plan year based on your claims. That's not a minor. That's Delta Dental or Delta Dental. That's Emeritus's numbers. What's that net out for a fixed cost? That's $422 a year. It's not that big a deal. They're one of few that will administer your dental and the way you want it and administer your vision. Keeps it a lot easier for one carrier. Any questions on that one? Anybody? Dental plan didn't change. We're keeping everything the same. Okay. They had 945 procedures dental. They're using it. and it just kind of shows you type 1s, you're always your highest percentage, type 2. And that's good. You want that number to be high. If that number's low, that means people aren't getting preventive done.
Type 1, basically cleanings and so forth like that.
Yeah. Type 1 is. That's about a ratio. That number should be, 50 and 35 and 20. That's kind of the breakdown. I don't disagree with that. Looks fine. And then like I said, because it's only 50 cents, they're going to increase the division administration by 50 cents. And that's $738 a year. And they think your vision's going up a little bit. That's trend. We're seeing that with fully insured plans, 3 to 5%. So as you see there, it's 50 cents going to a dollar. That nets out $738. Yeah. Any questions on that?
No.
Anybody? All right. Next one, COBRA administration. No change on that. All right, now I'll move through discussion quick. Medical plan enrollment period, I need to talk. I go downstairs and we'll find out when we're going to do the open enrollment period. Sue will have to distribute the SBCs. I'll talk about that. That Patient Center Outcomes Research Institute fee that goes into effect, it's $2.26. That's not us. That's the government charging. That goes into effect. It's due December, July 31st. We help Sue with that, so we're on top of that. One thing I want to address, that our monthly consultant fee will need to be increased to $12 per covered member. For those of you who weren't here, Willie would have been here. In 2009, we charged $8.50. That's what our cost was, $8.50. And when we put that into place, we put a two-year rate guarantee on it. We didn't change it to 2013 to $10. Okay? So it hasn't been changed since 2013. It just needs to be. We need to up it. Still, I'm not trying to tell you got a great deal, but it's still lower than our lower. But it was $8.50, and we gave you a two-year rate guarantee, and then we didn't change it till 2013. All right, any questions on that? Anybody? Nope. All right. Next one. Doctor on demand. Virtual doctor. All the plans, all your plans are going to have. I'm going quick as I can, Willie. In here. All right. Your plans will have that. This will get distributed to all your employees. Everybody's heard of virtual, where you now can call a doctor on the phone, on the computer, on the phone, on your phone, by looking at them, showing your symptoms, whatever, for the basic stuff such as cold, flu, bronchitis, sore throat, allergies, fever, headaches, pink eye, skin conditions, mental health, so forth. No cost for it. And matter of fact, it saves. The employee would just pay the copay that they're paying now. They don't pay any extra for it. So if you got any of those symptoms, you can call the number, and we'll get more information to the employees. But I just want you to know that's going to be on the plan July 1st. It's a saver for the plan because an average office visit at Walmart costs about $160. If they use this, it's $50. Mm-hmm. So if people use it, and I will tell you this, our experience has been the first year people, they're a little skittish about it. But as time goes on, we've started to notice people are starting to use it. 5 years from now, it'll be an everyday thing. The mental health, we talked about already. Wellmark utilization, we've already talked about. Applied behavior therapy, we talked about that last meeting. That's going into effect 7-1 on your plan. That's already been put in there. And the last thing I wanted, that's not on here, but I wanted to make sure, I didn't know if Sue passed on the word. About a month ago, put it down as Barron's Management Group merger. Did she, I don't know if she told you anybody about that, okay? Did she? She did. That merger went into effect about a month ago, so forth. And North Risk Partners is the company that we merged with. North Risk Partners. I have put all four of you on an announcement list that you will be getting, email. So you'll get the information. It doesn't mean anything to the county. I mean, you still get me. They didn't get rid of me, unfortunately.
Really? Can't change that, huh?
No change. Waste basket's still where it's at. The copy machine's still where it's at. Our building's still where it's at. Our offices, everything's changed. We're just going to have a different name, and there will be a different email and so forth. But that's all coming, okay? You'll get notice of that. And I put all four of you on that list. Should get it in the next week or so, okay? That's all I got. All right, Willie, I need some approval.
You need an approval of the renewal?
I need approval of the renewal, and I suppose you guys got to decide whether I'm worth another $2. Well, probably be the other thing that's.
How much time do we have to debate that?
Huh?
Okay. Sue, anything to throw in here, since you're the work with this the most? You're good to go?
No.
Yeah.
I assume you'll work on making some changes because of
yes.
money.
Yeah.
You know, the
yeah.
Fund balances that we have.
Yeah.
So that's a very important thing to look at. But until you know what you can change.
And this is April. You know, this... I think I would probably just schedule a meeting out there and primarily secondary roads and go talk to them and kind of tell them what we're doing. I don't know why they would be really opposed to this opioid, that change. It looks like that should be a, and then talk to the guys over there. So.
Are you saying that it may be July 1st?
Can we add it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not making any promises.
Okay.
I'll talk to Galloway, and then I'll see if we want to go out and talk to those guys.
Okay.
Okay? So we need a motion to approve renewing our contract with the Barron's Group.
So move.
Second. Did I hear you?
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't hear you. Motion made and seconded.
He whispered.
He was pretty shy about that. I don't know, maybe...
So you will get back to me on that,
yeah.
So I can get
yeah.
the paperwork to, yeah. to you to sign for that. Okay.
I'll get right. back to you within.
Thank you.
A short period.
We got before I probably come back. If I'm back here, yeah. Good luck on the next election. So, I mean, I just, whatever, we're going to see you again, and it was good working with you.
Yeah.
All right, okay. All right.
We voted, didn't we? We just never got to discuss.
We need to vote.
Yeah.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Oh, we did, aye. We did vote. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're good to go.
Thank you. Sorry.
But apologize
this is an important thing. It really is. It's just probably one of your biggest expenses in the county.
Oh,
so,
yeah. It's a big, it's a big deal.
If it's not the most expensive. So I think you need to take some time with it. So, all right. If anybody's got any questions, everybody's got my number, right? All right.
Yeah, we do.
Sorry.
Okay.
You're going to work on contacting Gallagher?
Yeah, I'll call Galloway.
Or Galloway, excuse me.
Now that we halfway know what we're doing, maybe. Okay. Committee reports. Dave Sadovic and I went to that Greenbelt thing, and we'll let Dave, when Dave is here, I thought Dave was coming this morning, but we'll discuss when on air. I think it's, given what we found out up there, we just will pull out of that thing. The only reason we're included in that is because there's a little, that trail thing goes from the 92 bridge to Fort Dodge. And the reason we're included, the Des Moines River must just above the bridge touch a little bit of Mahaska County.
Oh, just north of the bridge on the curve?
Yeah, and they're talking, the original plan was a trail maybe from Red Rock all the way to Atomo, but I think Fort Dodge and Pella and Des Moines will pretty well gobble up the money for a number of years, so I don't see that trail going anywhere right now. So I'll see what Dave said. We talked about maybe just dropping out of that, so let's see what happens. We kind of felt it was a waste of time that morning we went up there. Anything else? Public comments?
No, we have
to. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to tell you, the other committees, we have an EMA 911 meeting this evening.
Yep. Our mental health region is sponsoring a CIT training, which is, we sent already three of the local law enforcement to in San Antonio, Texas. And so we're paying out of the mental health to bring the trainers to Oskaloosa. And it really is helping to identify people, you know, helping law enforcement officers to, in the jail too now, some of the jailers are going to attend, to identify if they're dealing with somebody who's in mental health crisis or who's actually in a criminal behavior, I guess. And so it's a good training. It's reputable all over the country. It's cutting edge. And so we're hosting it here. There are representatives from Oskaloosa, Mahaska County Sheriff's Department, New Sharon's police officer is going to attend. Jesse already has done that. And three from the jail are going to attend. So I think that's really good. They're taking mental health pretty seriously here. So I think it's good. That's going to be held here the 23rd through the 27th, so next week. It's a 40-hour training.
Hmm. That's in April?
Yep.
Okay, next week.
Yep.
That's what those emails were about.
Mm-hmm. All right. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Support.
Motion made and seconded. To adjourn, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.